Hey everybody, Syntax 77 here, and I know what some of you might be thinking. Didn't I just do an episode of
Mail, Mountains of It? It'll be a red letter day when the postman blows mail call.
Well, the answer to that is yeah. It has only been a few days since the last episode, but the reason is, besides the fact that I just enjoy doing these, end up covering a bunch of fun topics related to backpacking and whatnot, I am kind of in between trips right now. I just got back last night from a backpacking trip, as alluded to in my previous mail call video. I just got back from that trip last night, and I literally only have a handful of days, a few days or something like that, until I turn right back around and head up to New England, White Mountains kind of area for another trip. So in that little span, I figure I'd do a quick mail call because they're kind of fun. And also, on the way back home yesterday from Pennsylvania, where I did that trip, I picked up this package at the post office. Looks kind of fun, kind of big. What could be in there? So I figure let's take a look inside this, and then I'll read some viewer comments and stuff too. Maybe I'll do a few viewer comments first, and then open the package, maybe a couple more. So let's just throw up a couple. Stoked for the solo videos. Yeah, me too, for sure. One down, one to go, right? In the near future, at least. Lots of concerned comments about the revelations with Sarah and whatnot. Some of you took that very seriously, which I appreciate your concern. Maybe we'll get to that. You should do the superstitions. When are you coming back to Arizona to do one of our ultimate backpacking trips, the Grand Canyon? Woo! That would be awesome. Maybe someday. Definitely want to get back out west, like desert southwest someday, maybe when the flight price is right. And the Grand Canyon specifically, that would probably be a bucket list type thing, right? Very awesome. But I don't know when specifically. Someone wants to know where I got the name tape that was on my polar fleece in the last mail call video. My mom purchased those, I think, online somewhere. I'm sorry, I don't specifically know. I can find out. But those are like the little name tags that normally would be issued to you in the military. I got one that says Syntax 77. I have a few of them, actually. And I'm pretty sure my mom just got them offline or online. I can try to find out for you. Or maybe somebody can chime in the comment section where you can get custom military style patches, the Velcro ones. And then also, speaking of that polar fleece that's in that video, somebody commented on that and thought it came from like Target or something. They might have been joking, but I saw some comments back and forth. Yeah, it is actually a military surplus. That one's either Army or Air Force, but it's like a liner. It doesn't have to be a liner. I wear mine by itself. It's very warm. But if you put it in between a hard shell or another jacket, it gets super warm. I would say it's comparable in function, or I should say comparable in warmth, to my Montbel. It's right over here. My Montbel Ultralight Down Parka. This is like 8 ounces and compresses down super small like this. So that's the advantage of this. This probably has a bit of an edge on the fleece. But honestly, for me, a lot of times it's interchangeable. When I just went on my Pennsylvania trip, I had a choice between this and the fleece. I just went ahead and took the fleece. Now, the disadvantage of the fleece is that it is bulkier and heavier. The advantage of it is, well, it's designed for the military, so you can beat the crap out of it, run it over with a truck. You can even puncture it. It's not probably going to, you know, fall apart too quickly, at least, compared to like this. If I ran this over with even a light car, this would be pretty torn up, I would imagine. Whereas, like I said, I could run that fleece over and have no problem. Now, I don't usually run my clothes over. I'm just using that as a weird example, I guess. But you get the point. So, because packability and weight is an advantage with this, I take this more often on trips where it's going to just be in my pack and I may or may not need it. Like, say, White Mountains, for instance. Not in the winter like I am now, but like in the summer or fall where you're hiking and you're fine in a t-shirt, but then all of a sudden you stop and then a cold front comes through or some weird weather. You pull this guy out, you slap it on, you're good to go. But most of the time when it's in your pack, it's not taking up much space or weight. With the fleece, though, if it's a trip where I know I'm going to be wearing it the whole time, I find it's comfortable and it's one less thing to worry about in terms of gear getting damaged, because this is very you know, it's robust. This is like 5 or 6 years old, and I have no rips on it, but you have to treat it carefully. With the fleece, if it's going to be on all day, it doesn't really matter to me. True, I'm carrying it on me, but there's just something more natural about wearing something on your body very close than being on your back. So I don't really notice it as a terrible thing to wear a couple extra ounces and like a jacket. And it's pretty comfortable for me. Like I said, I keep a hard shell over top of it like I just did on this Pennsylvania trip. It's kept it on the whole time. And when I started overheating going uphill on some steeper sections, I hit the a section of Appalachian Trail up there. I just took my hard shell off, bundled it up, and put it on the back of my pack and kept going. And then the wind could come through and it breathed and it was nice and comfy. So anyway, that's kind of a random tangent that I just went on, but that's polar fleece, military surplus versus $180 down jackets, which is another thing that I didn't mention, but cost. Big advantage on the military fleece. Anyway, yeah. So there you go. That's how these videos work. I find a comment and we end up going on a spiel. And then you guys and gals can comment in the comment section. Get a little conversation going. You know what? That was actually probably a nice little tangent, speaking of that. So let's open this thing right now. Now, I have to be honest, always try to be. I get random packages quite often and letters. This right here, I did know it was coming, and I know roughly what it is. Now, its box is bigger than I expected, so something else has to be in here, I'm assuming, and I'm not sure what. But the main thing I know it is an item from Katadyn, who I have the Be Free filter from most recently. They sent me that for evaluation, and I've been using that and legitimately really liking it. So they reached out and said, and it was perfect timing. It was like right when I was really gearing up to plan this winter White Mountains trip. And I was thinking about stoves already. I really was, because I have an upright canister stove, and then I have my old school MSR rapid fire stove, which looks a lot like a Whisper Light, and it basically is, but it's old version from the 80s that they made to take canister stove like fuel like this. I've talked about it before. I have a separate video on it that you can check out if you want to get the gist of it. But anyway, that thing's reliable and great, and I do like the fact that it does inverted canister fuel, which I won't dive into too deeply, but when you have a system that allows you to flip over your fuel canister, which would have a remote line off of it, really the only way to do it, then you can get these down to even colder temps. That's why I bought that rapid fire stove, and that's why I was thinking about it for my next trip. But they reached out and said, do you want to try out any of our stoves? And I was like, you know what, let me take a look. And I was like, I might as well look for something that does inverted canisters. And they said, we have two models that'll do that. Which one are you interested in? One was kind of like my rapid fire in that all it did was canisters, because that's all I can use with my rapid fire. But it was much more modern, lighter for sure. And I was really enticed by that because, you know, I do like ultralight or lighter weight conscious backpacking gear. But I was like, you know, when I go out and I really want to be light, I just use my little, I'm looking around the room for it, but it's not out. I just use my little $5 cheapy stove, my upright canister stove, which I have a video on as well if you want to check that out. And for warm weather, that works just fine. So I was thinking, why reinvent the wheel? I already have the rapid fire. Yes, it's older and heavier for sure, but it is reliable and it serves that function as a canister only stove system. What I don't have though, surprisingly after all these years, I don't have a stove that can run off of white gas, which is very common. It's actually right here. You might be wondering why I own this. Well, the reason that I have this is also the answer as to why I've gotten away for so many years without buying one of these stoves. I have two friends, Mike, aka Trail Killer, aka Trail Slippa, and my friend TJ, both have MSR stoves that can run white gas. TJ's is specifically, I believe, white gas. And then Mike got the MSR Whisper Light International, because you know he has to do things big or not at all. And his one runs all kinds of different fuels. The only downside that he's told me is, because I got excited when he told me that years ago, I'm like, wow, I can run on gasoline and white gas, and you can also use canisters and kerosene and diesel and all kinds of craziness. And he was like, yeah, but it's got this whole little kit and all these pieces, so it's kind of a pain to switch it over. It's not something I would like do on the trail, especially for us because we do shorter trips anyway. But I was like, oh, okay. So he pretty much put it in white gas configuration, and I don't think he's ever taken it out of that configuration because there's like different nozzles and stuff you have to mess with. Well, to get back on track here, the other stove that Katadyn had, and by the way, these stoves are actually branded as Optimus. That's like a sister, it's part of the Katadyn group, I think. So it's an Optimus stove, but it's actually with Katadyn. Anyway, they have a stove that does all those different fuel types, so I can finally get into that world, because some of those fuels, like the white gas, you can go down real low in temperature, lower than canister stoves. And also you have the flexibility, of course, if you're somewhere weird and you ran out of fuel, oh shoot, what am I gonna do? As long as you can find a gas station and get gasoline, you can run it. But the cool difference with theirs, from what I read so far, and we'll find out in real world testing when I go up to New Hampshire, is that supposedly it just has a system where you don't have to mess around with all those different nozzles. Pretty cool. For a nerd like me, I get to experiment with a bunch of different fuels and maybe, you know, it'll be a little less finicky. So enough of my talking. Well, then again, I guess I have to keep talking because otherwise I'd just be sitting here like this. I'm pretty sure you guys wouldn't keep watching. So I'll keep talking, but I'll start opening. Attention, we interrupt this broadcast with some breaking news. Syntax 77 will be... Oh, wait, that's me. This is kind of weird. Okay, look, check it out. Katadyn reached out to me, obviously because of the stove, but they also followed up and asked me if I'd be interested in doing a live event on Facebook, on their Facebook page. I believe it's called Facebook Live. All the kids out there are using it these days, apparently. They asked if I want to do one to discuss the trip, kind of logistics-wise. Specifically, what gear I took, the choices that went into it, and how the trip went. We're going to do it after the trip. So it's going to be on February 15th at 1 p.m. on the Katadyn Facebook page. I'll put some links to their page in my video description. And also, you can follow me on Twitter and Facebook if you want any updates. But as of right now, February 15th at 1 p.m. is all you need to know. Tune in. And like I said, I'll be talking about gear, how the trip went, all that. But on top of that, it should be pretty cool opportunity for anybody who wants to chime in with questions about, I don't know, whatever's on your mind specific to that trip or just backpacking in general. So come on over and join the party on Facebook Live, February 15th at 1 p.m. Ooh, first things first. Now this is separate. Does that mean that you buy them separate? It looks like the fuel bottle. I'll get to that in a second. Just to answer my own question, no. Aha, so that's why it's bigger. You know, I was going to go out and buy a separate fuel canister for the reasons I mentioned, if I want to test different fuels in the field. But they must have known I'm a nerd, because it looks like they sent me an extra one, but I could be wrong. It looks like a bottle in here, too. So there it is. And this is the first time I've seen it. Now, I've read up on it, of course. And it's the Optimus Polaris OptiFuel. Polaris. So Optimus is the brand. Polaris is the model. So let's open it up. Here's the fuel bottle. Comes with a little 300 milliliter, 10 fluid ounce fuel bottle right there. And I'm just going to go over the overview of this. Just keep in mind that, well, I'll do a separate video most likely where I really nerd out and use all the different fuel types. And then most importantly for me, I'm going to take this up to New Hampshire. So I'll probably be showing it off in that video, hopefully out in some deeper snow and some actual cold temps. The actual stove is right here. And I'd be curious, like, especially now that I'm getting into this, do you guys have any opinions on your favorite go-to fuels to use? I mean, do you just stick with these and do the inversion every once in a while? Or maybe you never even need to do that, depending on where you backpack, if it's not too cold. I know at, like, I'd say below freezing, I go ahead and flip my can over, if possible, and invert it. Because I've taken it down to 15 back years ago on my first snowshoeing trip. I took an upright canister stove, the type you just screw on, like I was talking about earlier, that I wouldn't do this again. And I had a little mini fuel can, and it worked great at first. And I was like, oh, what's the big deal? It's working fine. And it's 15 degrees out. I probably should mention that. That's important. It was like 15 degrees or lower, and it was working just fine. But it conked out, the fuel can did, well before it was empty. Like, you could pick it up and shake it, and you could hear it in there, the fuel. But the reason is because they do fuel mixes in here. Propane is one of the best cold temperature gas fuels, but it's also very high pressure, I guess would be the best word. So it requires big old tanks, like picture a propane tank for your barbecue. That thing's solid, right? And therefore heavy. Butane, on the other hand, is pretty ubiquitous, works really well. It's less pressurized or less high pressure. I'm sure scientists out there are hating my terms right now, but you get the point. So you can put it in really small containers like this. This thing is like basically a hairspray type canister. You can tell I'm actually pressing on it, and I just put a dent in it. So obviously butane, I refill my lighter with this, is not very high pressure because it can go in a light container like that, but it's terrible compared to the other fuels as soon as the temp starts getting cold. I forget the actual amount, but you know. So what they do is isobutane and propane in a mixture, so you get kind of the best of both worlds. It's not quite as high pressure and needing of a extra weighty container, but it's also not going to completely let you down when it's cold. Then there's white gas that can go down even lower. And white gas, by the way, we're just going all over the place today. Hope you really enjoy talking about stoves, or maybe wait for the next video. White gas, from what I found out recently, is basically just gasoline that is refined so that it burns a little cleaner. And then on top of that, from what I've read, it's basically the equivalent of like a 50-something, 50-ish octane gasoline, which you wouldn't want to put this in your car, I don't think. You know, when you go to a gas station, they have like 87, 89, and that other one with the 9 in the front that I've never bought in my life. So this is the equivalent of a low-octane gasoline, basically, but it burns better. Anyway, this is one of the best fuels for cold weather, as far as I know. Okay, so this is the nozzle for the bottle. Basically, you have your liquid fuel in there, you put that guy in, get it reasonably tight, and then this will hook up to a fuel line, which looks like it's right on the stove, and you pump it to pressurize it. That's where your pressure's coming from. And so every once in a while, you do have to pump these, which is something when you're using canister, you don't have to worry about. But I find it's a pretty good trade-off for being able to have a very reliable stove in very cold temps. On and off nozzles right there to control the fuel flow and therefore the simmering abilities, which is something I want to check out on this stove. I know on my rapid fire, which like I said, is similar to a whisper light, which is pretty common, it could simmer really well. I could get it down low. Whereas my upright canister cheapy stove, not only did it have a really narrow flame pattern, it wasn't that great, you couldn't get it down to a real low simmer consistently. It would start to do that thing where it's like, you know, the flame's kind of flickering almost and gasping. Whereas with these systems, they seem to be better for getting a consistent low simmer. So hopefully that'll be the case with this system too. Let me go to my scale and see what these components actually weigh. Okay, could have just read the box, but 11.5 ounces is what I rang up for this, the actual stove. You're going to need this no matter what. So this is your minimum weight if you were going to go with the canister stove setup. If you're going to go liquid fuel, then you're going to definitely need this, of course. And you will need both of these, a bottle and this. This was 3 ounces and this was 5. So 19.5 ounces. So that's weight. Oh, what do we got here? Okay, so a windscreen, nice and light. Windscreen that goes around it. That's cool. I have something similar for my MSR. So I know there should be, right here, you can run the fuel line out. I'm telling you, wind is a very, I believe, underrated factor on stoves as far as efficiency. Yeah, if you're out on a backpacking trip, you got like a whole can for like one night, you have no windscreen, you probably never think about it, but you are burning a lot more fuel than you realize compared to if you have a nice solid windscreen and all that heat isn't being sucked off of the flame, bottom of the pot, in addition to the more obvious, like if it's really windy, it's just actually gonna blow your stove out, or at least attempt to. And then a heat reflector for the bottom. So if you put this in the mix on the bottom, you have this kind of setup here, and you're really trapping heat in there as well, so that's not dissipating into the world. It's staying near your pot and helping boil stuff faster, so you can turn it off more quickly and save on fuel. No Icelandic, meh. A single jet technology, it delivers excellent cooking performance on LPG gas, so that's liquid propane gas, I believe, or liquid petroleum gas. I don't know. I think they're talking about this. White gas, which would be this, we already talked about. Gasoline, which makes sense because it's very similar to this. It just burns a little dirtier. Kerosene. Diesel. Now, I haven't gone too far into my research on this, but similar to white gas and gasoline, from what I can tell, and I never realized this until recently, diesel and kerosene are pretty similar as well. I don't know if it's as similar as gasoline and white gas, but I believe most of the time, if you see something runs on kerosene, it can also run on diesel. I think it's just that the kerosene is more refined and it runs better. By the way, I'm not advising you to actually try that with your device. Much like heating oil is actually basically interchangeable with diesel. I've run out of fuel before in my heating system, unfortunately. Wasn't able to get a delivery of heating oil quick enough. I just went and bought like 5 gallons of diesel fuel and it worked fine. So my point is a lot of these fuels are actually more similar than you think. Just do your research, of course. And then jet fuel, which I thought before jet fuel was similar to kerosene, but now I learned that kerosene's similar. I don't know. It's a whole new world of things to nerd out on, like I said. When using LPG gas, so yeah, that means that is what they're referring to when they say that. This can. It says, when using LPG gas, you can switch between efficiency mode, as they call it, and four-season mode for usage at low ambient temperatures by simply opening the integrated support legs and turning the canister upside down. Okay, so by efficiency mode, they mean what I would call inverted canister mode. So, yeah, it doesn't look like I have to buy any adapters or anything like that, and everything's ready to go just right on the stove. That's crazy. I thought I at least have to do some sort of adapter for this, but according to that, I don't. Wow, look at that. Okay, so right there, that does look like threading for my canister stove. I should probably make sure this is off before I do that, right? Boy, I've done that before. I've seen others do that before, too. You know, you pack this thing down. Maybe not this one, but some stoves, you pack them down in a certain way that you have to have this maybe open a little bit. And then when you come and connect your stove together, remember to tighten it down first because it'll just start spewing everywhere. I'm not even going to tighten it all the way. But yeah, that goes right on there, my canister. So I'm assuming this guy has the same threading. That is so simple and cool. I mean, that's great. So I was thinking I would at least have to do something if I was going to bring white, say I brought white gas and gasoline in different bottles. You wouldn't necessarily do this just for testing, I mean. And then one of these, I was thinking I'd at least would have to switch things up to get this on there, but it looks like not really. Now, like I said, some fuels burn cleaner, some burn dirtier. You'll learn the ones you like. This tool here does various things for taking the stove apart, I assume. But there's also a magnet in here. Now, on my old MSR, I don't have it, sorry. I have to carry this little tool that's like a little piece of metal with what looks like a sewing needle, almost even thinner little piece of metal on it for cleaning the jets. If it starts running inefficiently, you can use that to clear the jets out. This one, there's no little part to miss or lose, which I'm always thinking I'm going to do with that other system. There's apparently a needle integrated in here, internally, that always sits there. And if I just take this magnet and wave it underneath, even while the stove is actively burning, it's moving the needle up and down and cleaning it. Pretty cool. But we'll check the performance out on that trip. Okay, so enough about that. You know, I actually ended up running a little long, so I guess my last viewer comment type thing will be the several people that are wondering maybe an update on Sarah because, you know, that whole thing. Where's Sarah? Well, Sarah has disappeared. Here's what we know. She's somewhere in Mexico, has something to do with a AAA or minor league baseball team. I don't know. Down there's some guy with a mullet that's trying to make a comeback in baseball. He always wears black, which is weird. I mean, who does that anymore? That's about all I know. So, well, actually, come to think of it, so my next trip is New Hampshire. After that, I'm thinking the next backpacking trip / travel adventure trip is we're all gonna have to go down to Mexico and find Sarah, find out what's going on. That's all I know for right now. Yeah. Anyway, I have not... That's all I know. That's all I can share for now. I guess stay tuned on that separate front. But in the meantime, I got plenty of fun new backpacking stuff to play with. Looking forward to that. And yeah, So till next time, I'm Syntax77, and you have fun out there.